of medical line for last 150 years on charitable basis. The company has leveraged its experience of developing and manufacturing air handling equipments for defense and railway applications and have now developed state-of-the-art products for medical applications. Dr. A.K. Agarwal is a technocrat with over 40 years of experience in augmenting the growth in high-tech companies and in spearheading successful global technical alliances. He has developed deep insights in innovating resilient leadership. Perfect blend of research, philanthropy, entrepreneurship, and innovation. Here, I welcome Dr. A.K. Agarwal, the chairman of River Engineering Private Limited. Please welcome him with a round of applause. Dr. Gautam Singh is one of the most sought-out cardiologists in India, director of Sri Ram Singh Hospital and Heart Institute, very actively involved with Indian Medical Association and its functioning, has held many key posts. He is also an elected member of the Central Council and presently president of Indian Medical Association, EDB. He is actively involved in the social causes and is on the management committee of the Baha'i Lotus Temple. Here, I welcome Dr. Gautam Singh, the president of Indian Medical Association, EDB. Please welcome him with a round of applause. Professor Dr. Kavita Shah is a well-known scientist. She is reputed biotechnologist and director at the Institute of Environmental and Sustainable Development, Banaras Hindu University. She is notable for her role in the area of environmental biotechnology, health, and water resource management. Here, I welcome Professor Kavita Shah, the professor and administrator. Please welcome her with a round of applause. Mr. Deepak Parvatiyar is a senior journalist who has held prestigious positions in media industry, both in India and abroad. He is also media advisor of Indian Federation of the United Nations Association. He is backed by many national and international awards for excellence. Here, I welcome Mr. Deepak Parvatiyar. Please welcome him with a round of applause. Now I request Dr. A.K. Agarwal to kindly welcome the guests. I request Dr. A.K. Agarwal to kindly present a bouquet to Dr. Gautam Singh. A big round of applause for him. I request Dr. A.K. Agarwal to kindly present a bouquet to Professor Kavita Shah. Can I please have a big round of applause? I request Dr. A.K. Agarwal to kindly present a bouquet to Mr. Deepak Parvatiyar. I request Mr. Neeraj Kaista to kindly present a bouquet to Dr. A.K. Agarwal.
Sound is okay? Now okay? So, this seminar or this conference is on air quality, as he explained. And in brief, I just tell you, Dr. Gautam Singh is a renowned cardiologist, and he is IMA chief today. And he has come over here. You know that doctors normally do not come; they do not have time. But I requested him. He is a friend of mine. He came here on friendship basis. So I welcome him. I welcome you, sir. Thank you very much. Professor Kavita Saha, a renowned scientist. She is director in Banaras Hindu University in Environment Institute. I know her for a long time. All the way she has come from Banaras Hindu University because of the connectivity with the topic, not because of otherwise. So she has come from Banaras Hindu University just to tell you about the importance of air quality, and especially after COVID. Mr. Deepak Parvatiyar, normally he does not talk about India. He talks about United Nations, World Health Organization. He is basically media advisor of IFUNA, Indian Federation, United Nations Association. Most of the times he is abroad. He is backed by so many awards. I think he does not remember how many awards he is having. I welcome you. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I welcome you all that you have come on Sunday. Vaibhavji, he is from Ministry of Railways. And also, Pramodji, you are also from Railway, but now in Ministry of Finance. And Saxenaji, you are running basically metro in Noida. So we are dependent on you. We are dependent on you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Now I request Dr. Gautam Singh to kindly address the August gathering.
Thank you very much. I'm very excited to be here today, especially, you know, as doctors now, we are more looking towards, you know, improving the quality of life of people, and also looking at making a more meaningful and a happier and a healthier life for most of the people. So today what we are going to understand, what I just wanted to talk to you all, that medical science is actually evolving. Before, we used to actually go to a doctor when we wanted the doctor to heal us because we were not well, we were sick. But now the concept is changing. We are looking at more healthier options. We are looking at more, you know, going towards more not getting sick at all. We don't want to get sick. We don't want to fall ill. We don't want, you know, these small problems to occur to us on daily basis. And this also is attributed to a better diagnostic and medical equipments and availability and approachability. If we see the statistics now, around 50 years back, we would say that a life expectancy of an Indian male is around 55 years average. And now it is increased up to 72 to 75 years at an average. So definitely we are moving towards an healthier option. Definitely we are able to provide better services and better quality to our patients and the people all around. At the same time, if you'll see, we have moved from industrial revolution now to more of green revolution and economy revolution. So what that is, before we used to only work to earn money so we could live and support our family. Today, general public is not in that situation. We are much better off. So we want a little bit more, not only just have an income, but also have a healthier and a happier life. we want green buildings, we want to you know, conserve energy, we don't want the sunlight to, you know, put more pressure on our air cooling system. Because of that, we want to have our windows sealed off, we don't want the polluted air to come in. But what is happening inside is also something that concerns us, and that should concern everybody. So today we are going to a little bit understand about the sick building syndrome. So as a doctor, you know, we'll always talk about diseases and syndrome. So there is something, an entity, very interesting entity, coined as a sick building syndrome, in which what happens is, when a person is going to a building, particular building, and working over there, you know, in the daytime, or just attending to the building for any reason, they will experience a little itchiness in the eye, or a little bit stuffy nose, or a little bit rashes somewhere. But the minute they are out of that building, they start feeling comfortable and they are okay again. So they don't realize, but this, the building is actually making the person sick. So it is called as the sick building syndrome. And definitely we need to consider all these things, because being unhealthy is not an option today. We want to have a healthy life and a healthy lifestyle. So we know basically there are many kind of pollutants that affect our atmosphere and affect our indoor air also, like landfills must be there, constructions must be there, industrial activities around our area that go on, agriculture, you know, burning of the farms that are there, and also household products. Now household products are one of the very important parts of the air pollution. Household products like what? Simple perfume, deodorants, hairsprays, you know, adhesives for the furniture. We may be having paints on the wall, polish of the wooden furniture. These all contribute to the indoor air pollution, and abundant everywhere, especially in our hospitality industry. So moisture also contributes to the indoor air pollution, along with smoking, dust, volatile, and pets, animals, even plants, if sometimes we have indoors, they could contribute to air pollution in indoors. So what will this result into? Not only just simple, you know, sneezing, cough, headache, it may go into something like, you know, eye and skin irritation, but it can worsen asthma, it can cause shortness of breath, it can cause dizziness, fainting attacks, and a basically unpleasant experience to people. Where the research now shows that we are spending more than 90% of our times indoor, we are only spending 10% of our times outdoor. We are either in the house, we are either in the car, or we are either at our workplace. Even when we go for holiday, we are mostly indoors now. And in the last 2 years, the concept of people have been changing. Now, constantly people are, rather than just wanting a, you know, a good holiday experience, they also want a healthier holiday experience. So this our hospitality industry has to catch up with that. So the biological content of the atmosphere, if it is there, it may cause a lot of bad effects to our health. Of course, we all know about PM 2.5, but this biological content that is there in our atmosphere, which may be the dead skin or debris, we shed a lot of dead skin every day. So humans, plants, animals, everything shed dead skins, and these attract the dust mites, which are one of the most potent allergens for a person to get allergy, including severe fatal attacks of asthma. There may be airborne bacteria, there may be fungi, there may be protozoas, and of course viruses, which are very important. And in the last 2 years, of course, viruses have gained the maximum attention from the people because of the COVID-19. So what are these viruses? I'll not take you into the detail of it. I know it's not your forte, but these viruses, they basically have got an envelope, and under the envelope they have their genetic material, and this genetic material, they are non-living organisms, but these genetic materials replicate. They may be present in animals, plants, even in bacteria may be infected with viruses. So these viruses are very simple, basic structures. They may be two types of viruses. We classify them broadly into DNA virus and RNA virus. We all heard about the RNA virus, which caused the COVID-19, the coronavirus, and we know how adaptive it can be, how adaptive an RNA virus can be. And usually these viruses, they don't want to kill the host. The viruses don't want to kill you. They don't want you to get very sick, because if you get sick and you get killed, the viruses will not survive. They will not replicate. They will not have their own life cycle. So the viruses just want to stay in the human genome. The viruses just want to stay in you without causing problem. So the viruses keep mutating. But sometimes when they mutate, they become very aggressive and they become very harsh on human bodies, and they can cause devastation like what we have seen in the past sometime. But normally viruses would cause much milder diseases. They would cause something like a rhinovirus may cause, simple common cold, influenza, measles, mumps, rubella. Viruses may also be aggressive sometime and cause diseases like viral meningitis, which is an infection of the covering of the brain and can cause a person to be really sick. Or a severe acute respiratory distress syndrome, which one of the part of that is the COVID-19, of course, swine flu. There are so many diseases of the virus which can cause acute respiratory distress syndrome. So how does this virus infect us? Basically, it enters the body and with its receptors, it gets attached to the human cell. And after getting attached, it enters the human cell and empties its genetic material into the human cell and replicates. After that, after replication, multiple copies of these viruses are made and they are exited out from the cells, and then hereby it infecting the other cells around it. And once it keeps infecting the other cells around it, our immune system in the body recognizes that, oh, there is an infection, there is a problem, and the immune system tries to attack that virus. And most of the time the immune system may be successful, but many times the immune system loses the battle to the virus. There may also be airborne bacteria that are there in the atmosphere. These bacteria are present everywhere. They are also very stubborn. They are they may be present in plants, they may be present in animals, they may be present in the human body. They may be present everywhere, even in the soil these bacteria are present. And they cause a little bit more serious infection. So a person who's infected with bacteria may aggressively start getting sick. But a person who's infected with the virus may just keep on feeling unwell for most of the time. It should not be surprising to know that what other kind of diseases these airborne infections can cause. Not only from, simple asthma to chronic bronchitis, but these can cause skin rashes, cough, sore throat, neurological defects, even birth defects can be caused and attributed to these airborne viruses. They may cause, when a very small child is infected with virus, it may cause that small child to have developmental problems in future. So it's very important to have a good atmosphere around us. So these are just few facts that I wanted to put today forward to you. Mold, viruses, bacteria, allergens, volatile organic compounds and PM2.5 are the major source of indoor air pollution, and especially in our hospitality industry. Individual infected with influenza just with one sneeze may give out almost as many as 6 × 10⁻⁶ times of viruses, and with one cough may give out almost as much as 2 × 10⁵. That many amount of viruses just one infected person can expel in the atmosphere, and just imagine that how much that person is liable to infect other people around you if the air is not clean immediately or if the air still remains polluted. Our ventilation system is also not clean, accumulates a lot of bacteria. Our HVAC system also accumulates a lot of bacteria, and the dust in them have many different type of bacteria, and many colonies of bacteria have been isolated from them. It's very interesting to learn that they do not collect viruses because they are not able to filter the viruses. So these bad indoor air qualities can have adverse effect on the teamwork of people who are working, especially in the hospitality industry. What we want today is a healthier team to work with, because otherwise that calls in for more sick days, that calls in for more leaves, that calls in for more irritability at work, more disruption, and then people are not able to give their best to the team that they are working for, and not able to give their best to the business they are working for. The bad air quality can also influence the experience of the guest. You may not know, but the guest may just feel uncomfortable, unhappy and unhealthy, because actually they have come for a good experience to especially to a hotel or a resort, they have come for a good experience. But if there is an unhealthy air in that area, the bad indoor air pollution that is there in that area may just give a bad experience to the guest without him actually pinpointing at what was bad. So they will not understand what was bad, but it is just giving them a bad experience. That may give you, you know, less stars on the, you know, probably the feedbacks that they will give. Also, that may increase our maintenance cost, because when we realize that, you know, we are not, people are not happy, we may invest more into the maintenance of that area. Why is the problem? What is the problem? To dig it, more of reactive work that we'll be doing. So hotel do need to have an effective hygienic indoor atmospheric, you know, air pollution solution that they need to have. So these airborne microbes and their spores, usually they resist many type of environmental stress and strain. Even it may be present deep in the earth crust, leave alone the, you know, the conventional filter system that we have. They are not able to filter out these viruses, and mostly these viruses. To clean the indoor microbial content, especially the viral, a very, very strong, you know, HEPA filter may be needed, which may clean almost up to 99.999% of the viruses. And to combat this situation, technical solution, there is a need for which we are looking at today. And now, one of the solutions that I found personally very effective is an air purification system. But this air purification system also has got a lot of variety. Most of the air purification system that I came across actually did not fit the criteria of having a HEPA filter with not less than 99.999% efficacy. So that is the kind of efficacy that we want in our HEPA filters, which also should have a UVC disinfector, and also it should address the have the air ionizer to address the fumigations and the other kind of air pollution that are there. So we need to have an air purification system which would have all these things. But do we find that? So I was doing a little bit more research where I stumbled upon the Petrimet CA system. I went in, I saw the manufacturing unit, I saw the systems of where things are working, and that caught my attention and interest into it, because of my interest into what the effects of air pollutions are there, and this is what is the most advancing. So the Petrimet CA system being manufactured by India, by the River Engineering Private Limited with the Canadian technology, provides such technical solution, and I would strongly recommend that we look into this as one of the technical solution for having a good and a healthier air, and a happy and a healthier and a disease free future for all of us and for our families. So thank you very much.
Now I request Professor Kavita Shah to kindly address the August gathering.
Well, I'm here to talk about the air quality. Just now we heard Dr. Singh about all the health effects and the issues related therein, related to the air quality. I will be talking a little bit in a different tangent what air quality is all about, and when we look at indoor air quality, what we say and how we feel about it. So let's go to some of the technical solutions to create virus-free environment for indoor air quality. Next, please. All right. So I'm starting something very basic. When we talk about air, we know there are five elements we are all made up of. Chiti Jal Pava Gagan Samira. That means we talk about five elements we see. And air is the first component. When a new child is born, the first thing it does is breathes. So that air is the one which gives life, it sustains life, it is vital for all of us. And if we look at, it contains n number of components, including different gases like nitrogen, oxygen, we all know of, argon, carbon monoxide, and of course, lot of water vapor. So the simple composition, which is a healthy composition, which we say, consists of these different gases. Globally, more than 3 million people are known to be affected, and they die because of air pollution. Almost 5% of all our annual global deaths. According to the World Health Organization, a recent study of 2011, which was pre-COVID, we find that 27 cities in India are highly air polluted, and of course largely because of the dust and PM 2.5. so PM 10 and PM 2.5 were the major concerns. In environmental terms, we call it as air pollution ecocide. That means when we are looking at bad air quality, when we survive in a bad air quality, then we are actually having so many different problems associated, health being of course one of these. Apart from health, if we look at, we are actually polluting each and every component of life on earth. That is very, very important, and this slide actually talks about this. Next, please. All right, so some of the mitigation measures, as we were talking, when we look at the air pollution aspect, certain available formats which we have, the devices, the different types of instruments which we have to combat or mitigate the air pollution. It includes the scrubbers, air filters, cyclones. I'm sure most of you might be knowing about the electrostatic precipitators. Of course, incinerators, mist collectors, and so on. And air filters and biofilters are also one such device. This is just a pictorial and an instrumental view of how all of these components look at. And this is the air filter part which we talk about. That means it consists with the air flow, that is the turbine system, and it has different layers of filtering which filters different components including PM10, PM2.5 and the microbes through subsequent filter beds. The National Ambient Air Quality Monitoring and the National Air Quality Category, that is AQI category, defines all these different ranges where you see it belongs from 0 to 50 to 51 to 100 and a severe case of 401 to 500. And with this COVID, the COVID pandemic which we have been seeing for the past 2 years, this poor and very poor category has been very predominant, mainly because of the microbial load, that is the viral load which we talk about. And this is directly associated to the health impacts which Dr. Singh was talking about, that if it is good, then it has a minimal impact on human health, and if it is severe, then of course it is related to so many other diseases, or human beings get affected to several diseases. And respiratory tract is the one, first one, that is the minor breathing discomfort. So as soon as the air quality index starts falling, what we see is that the severity or the respiratory problems, they begin. The first two, that is photochemical smog and the acid deposition, they are related to the outdoor-indoor air quality. But here, because we are at the hospitality industry and most of you are from there, we will be talking about this particulate matter and the microbial load which is present there in the AQI. VOCs and other things, sir has already spoken about, so I'm not going in detail of that. But of course, anthropogenic sources do have many other ways apart from the sulfur dioxide, the nitrox or NOxes, SOxes, and of course PM10, PM2.5, and carbon monoxide, which we look at. Apart from that, the microbial load. Route of invasion for respiration, basically through the lungs. So we see that the smallest ones being this. These units which are at the there, that's alveolar part of the lungs, which is the place from where actually the different microbes, the contaminants enter the human body. And if we look at these particles, they are less than 50 to 70 microns. Now the question is, can we control it? So if we have to control, we are actually thriving in that direction to control it. Of course, trees, we all know, are one such ways of doing it. Multiple environments, that is outdoor, indoor, and we keep on fluctuating between them. Between outdoor and indoor system, you keep on moving all the time, and therefore this becomes very important how we look at our both indoor air quality and outdoor air quality. And therefore, two good reasons to focus on indoor triggers is people spend more than 90%, and in actually COVID times we see even 100% people staying back home. So that is very, very important, and much easier to control indoor as compared to outdoor, because indoor systems you can control by your own measures. Conventional techniques we all do at home, vacuuming, damp mopping and so on, air conditioners, dehumidifiers you already have in place, but they are all not sufficient. Even HEPA filters at some times are not sufficient. So what we need is of course the air purification system, a composite air purification system, which is very important because the virus, dust and odor, all these things are very, very important in our indoor air system. And if we have the three systems, again, I agree with what Professor Dr. Singh has already said, that it needs to have all the three components, that is the high energy particulate air filter, that is HEPA filters, which have the efficiency of more than 99.999% or even more if we can achieve. We cannot have anything which we say in a system as 100%, but this is the best we can have. And of course, a UVC disinfector and an air ionizer. And before I come to the last slide, which is all the way from Banaras, what I will just like to say is that Petrimed CA, because we see that the coronavirus, the size of coronavirus which we have been looking at is about 0.125 microns, which we are going to address for the removal. And so far, there are very few units. I have seen all across, there are very few units, and most of them are either international brands, or what we see is that they are less efficient than 99.9%. So what we are looking now forward is a higher efficiency which can go below 0.1 microns so that we are able to contain the viruses in the environment under indoor conditions as well. So this Petrimed CA is one such options, and it has the HEPA filter with a sensitivity or efficiency of 99.99%, and I believe that this can be one of the very good units which can be housed in most of these industries, like even for the hotel industries, in restaurants and so on, because we also see that the units are very small and easily manageable. So they can be there, and with that we can have a good and appropriate indoor air quality, which we look forward to give a better and a healthy atmosphere to our visitors, the customers, the clients, and also to our family members. So with these words, I thank you all for listening, your patience listening. Thank you very much.
Now I request Mr. Deepak Parvatiyar to give his concluding remarks.
Good afternoon, everybody. Dr. Agarwal, Professor Shah, Dr. Singh. After what you have spoken, I don't have much to speak. You have raised very relevant point. What I would say here is that the WHO and the United Nations Environment Program, they have also now come up with some studies. The latest studies are there, and it has really picked up nowadays, because now there is a very distinct thought process that what is the correlation between COVID-19 and air pollution. And the latest report says that there is a correlation between COVID-19 and that was released only this month, and air pollution. You being in hospitality industries, you are the worst sufferers. You know it better than what we know. We were scared of using your hotels, and a very apt word that Dr. Singh said, it was a sick building syndrome that he talked about. And sick building syndrome is what we have to ponder about. This is one thing that we must very seriously think about, why people are scared of going to hotel, why they are not traveling out, even when this thing has subsided, people have got vaccinated, double vaccination is already there, but still people like us are very scared of moving to your places, to the hotels, and that you are the worst sufferers because of this. And I would just like to refer to certain points, and I would make one correction, just little update on what Professor Shah said. She mentioned that 3 million deaths happen every year because of air pollution. The updated figure that was updated only this month was 7 million. It is 7 million people who die of air pollution every day. And the other report is that 92% of these lives could have been, so 92% of, 1 minute, let me just correct it. Yeah, 92% of the world is exposed to polluted air. That is a huge number, 92%. And what is the percentage, what could have been saved? I will just read it out to you, that what is the percentage of people, lives that could have been saved if they had had enough precaution, something like a good air purification system. People don't know about even air purification system. Last year only I purchased one because I was feeling very suffocated because of the things. Then I had to go and explore in the market which is the best one, and I was confused. Which one should I buy? The range is also something, it is so flexible range, and which one you have to buy, and you go to the market and the market people, they will just brainwash you into buying their product. So something, when I came across what Dr. Agarwal mentioned to me about 99.999%, it was an eye-opener. This is the first time that I was educated about this thing. And when Dr. Singh, when I had a casual talk with him, he told me that even the best grade medical air purification system, they have 99.995 to 99.997% only. Am I right? So 99.999% when he came, we just jumped off our feet. This is something that we should, but if we are going to market, we are misguided. I would just like to quickly read out something, the report the WHO came up with only recently. That was this month only, last week. Air pollution has been identified by WHO as the single largest environmental health risk, with 92% of the world's population living in places where air pollution levels exceed safe limits, disproportionately affecting women, children, and elderly people in most of the countries. And recent studies suggest possible correlations between COVID-19 health outcomes and air pollution. If mortality rate is high, they have studied and they say that where air pollution was high, more people died. Now there is another report which I will refer to. This is a report on global air quality. The WHO this week only released a global air quality guidelines, where they mention that there is a clear evidence of the damage air pollution inflicts on human health at even lower concentrations than previously understood. So when we are talking of lower concentrations, we thought, "Arey, yahan to kuch bhi nahi hai, nothing hai, aisa to mamooli hai." But it is not. Even where there is lower concentration, it impacts you. The guidelines recommend new air quality levels to protect the health of populations by reducing levels of key air pollutants, some of which also contribute to climate change. So the impact is quite big. It is impacting the climate change also. So since, and you know, this is the update. The last update was in 2005. The WHO last update was in 2005, so it is after 15 years they have come up with that. And this COVID-19 necessitated that. And what now they have done, they have adjusted all air quality guidelines. They have adjusted everything, warning that exceeding the new air quality guideline levels is associated with significant risks to health. At the same time, however, adhering to them could save millions of lives. It is not one or two lives, millions of lives can be saved if we are adhering to these guidelines. And they are very specific about this, how the pollution is going to affect one's health. As Professor Shah mentioned, air is necessary for breathing. If a child is born, you see whether he's breathing or not. She said that. And that is so true. But what type of air are we breathing? Even if a child who's born, he is born with and breathing, the moment he is born, he is taking, he's inhaling polluted air. So what is his expectancy then? What is the life expectancy of a child? Have we ever thought about it? So here I will say, when I mentioned about 7 million premature death, it is mentioned here. Every year exposure to air pollution is estimated to cause 7 million premature deaths and result in the loss of millions more healthy years of life in children. When Professor Shah talked about infants, yeah. In children, this could include reduced lung growth and function, respiratory infections, and aggravated asthma. In adults, it is a medical term, so ischemic. Ischemic heart disease and stroke are the most common causes of premature death attributable to outdoor and indoor air pollution, and evidence is also emerging of other effects such as diabetes and neurodegenerative conditions. This puts the burden of disease attributable to air pollution on par with other major global health risks such as unhealthy diet and tobacco smoking. And we can think of it, what air pollution is doing to us. We have discouraged smoking, and now we are inhaling something. So is this a substitute to smoking or what? Okay, here one thing is, the WHO's new guidelines recommend air quality levels for 6 pollutants where evidence has advanced the most on health effects from exposure. When action is taken on these so-called classical pollutants, particulate matter, ozone, nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, and carbon monoxide, it also has an impact on other damaging pollutants. The health risks associated with particulate matter equal or smaller than 10 and 2.5 microns in diameter, that is PM10 and PM2.5 respectively, are of particular public health relevance. Both PM2.5 and PM10 are capable of penetrating deep into the lungs, but PM2.5 can even enter the bloodstream, primarily resulting in cardiovascular and respiratory impacts and also affecting other organs. So these are the things, and this is why we are scared of coming to your hotels and staying there, unless you take enough safeguards. I don't want to make you scared of all those things. What I want to say is that this is the time when we should take preventive steps, and what Dr. Singh said, that existing HVAC is not sufficient, that is not enough. So it is here what makes me feel happy is that persons like Dr. Agarwal have come up with certain things, some research, some resources, and he got the research done in Canada with one organization, PetriMed, and which is into research, I think, if I am wrong. Not wrong. They are not into marketing. They are into research, and he got them engaged, got this brand for manufacturing and marketing of fully loaded air purification system with design efficiency of 99.999%. I have already mentioned about that. And in built air ionizer as well as UVC disinfector. This is more relevant today. This is what I think. If I go through all these reports and be looking at all these things, this is very relevant, and I think everyone will agree. Doctor is here, he will agree with me. So this is what I wanted to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. And Sushmita will take over from here.
I must say, what a wonderful session it has been, extremely informative. And thank you for this lovely audience, the turnaround of so many people participating in together. Can we have a huge round of applause for such a valuable and a knowledgeable session? Thank you, esteemed and distinguished speakers of the head table. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. May I request, I once again thank the Reverend Engineering for such a wonderful session. May I now request everyone to kindly join us for lunch. and maybe we'll then slip into our next session, which will be on Purchase Managers Forum. With that note, I would say thank you once again, heartfelt gratitude, and may I request you all to kindly step forward for a photograph, just to capture this moment. And then we also like to present a memento to all our distinguished speakers. Who's present? May I request you all to put your hands together and congratulate each one of our speakers for contributing so wonderfully. An extremely important session which addressed the importance of the clean and virus-free air for hotel industry in the post-COVID times. Once again, thank you so much. Now may I request our members of the head table to kindly step forward for a group photograph.